Many Americans hear the word cryptocurrency and are puzzled at what it really means. It's a digital currency, but how does it work? Where do you buy it? Should you buy it? What's all this craze around Dogecoin? Crypto seems to be driving the future of currency, but there's no doubt that it can sometimes be quite confusing.
To wrap your mind around this is very difficult, and it challenges many of your assumptions about the nature of money and where safety and security come from in the financial system and so forth.
That's Dr. David Yermak, a professor of finance at the NYU Stern School of Business. He's been studying the rise of crypto for almost a decade and currently teaches the joint MBA and law school courses on Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies. He says that currently the most popular digital currency is Bitcoin, which was created back in 2008. Think of cryptocurrency like an arcade token that you can use to buy goods or services online. You can buy these digital tokens in exchange for traditional currency, but their value is always fluctuating and can be extremely unstable. One important aspect that's central to cryptocurrency is that it works using a virtual ledger called the blockchain that processes and records every transaction.
I think what we're dealing with now is a better accounting system that will be as important in the history of business and commerce as the introduction of double entry bookkeeping was 700 years ago. And the implication is very simple, that any business where data is important, and so you're talking about healthcare, banking, shipping and logistics, you know, you name it. It's hard to think, in fact, of any industry that doesn't use data very intensively. But the blockchain gives you a better way to secure and organize and protect data.
Yermak says that the big appeal of cryptocurrency is the impenetrable security of this digital blockchain technology. This process makes it impossible for anyone to counterfeit the currency, while also ensuring that it remains scarce even as more is generated over time. Take Bitcoin, for example.
Bitcoin is really a computer network, and the supply of Bitcoin increases every 10 minutes when somebody known as a miner wins a block by breaking a code. And when a miner wins a block, new Bitcoin are created and given as a reward to that miner. And so there's a mathematical function that at the start there were 50 Bitcoin every 10 minutes, and then every 4 years that gets divided in half. And so after 4 years, the reward was cut to 25 and 12 and a half, and in 2025 it will go down again and so forth. If you add all this up and you think about issuing coins every 10 minutes in a predetermined quantity, it just so happens that this ends up being 21 million coins by the year 2140.
Essentially, anyone could run a program to mine Bitcoin on their computer at home, albeit very slowly. This computationally intensive process also requires a lot of power. And for most people, the amount of electricity it uses cancels out the profit gained from generating new Bitcoin. Instead, most people trade for existing Bitcoin using dollars or even other cryptocurrencies through third-party platforms. Coinbase and Binance are some of the biggest names that people trade through today. And since there's a finite amount of Bitcoin that can ever be mined, the amount in circulation now and in the future is completely predetermined, unlike with traditional currencies.
The future supply and the increase in the supply is completely transparent and known in advance to everybody. And it's the total opposite of what the Federal Reserve does by tweaking the money supply at their monthly meetings, you know, based on their expert judgment and maybe a little more of this, a little less of that. This is just a mathematical function that is one of the oldest debates in central banking, whether you should have a predetermined money supply or whether you should give discretion to the experts. And Bitcoin very much is in the former camp, which makes it attractive to people who don't trust central banks.
While Bitcoin is the most well-known token, anyone can create their own cryptocurrency and shape the protocols that govern it, such as the scarcity. With many accepted cryptocurrencies booming, it's no surprise that new ones are popping up every day. But ultimately, the value of a new cryptocurrency is not decided by its creator, but by what others are willing to pay for it. So who's in charge of all these new coins?
Nobody is in charge of these networks because all they really are computer programs that everybody on the network agrees to opt into and to run. So there's no board of directors or president of Bitcoin, and there's really no way to engage in the seizure of assets or to involve law enforcement because nobody's in charge. So this is really the big innovation, but I don't think most people really understand that there's no entrepreneur or sponsor or authority figure. There's simply computer code that is behind all of this. And for that reason, it's very hard to hold anybody responsible or accountable when things go wrong.
The world of cryptocurrency is constantly evolving as new forms pop up. Take the exploding popularity of Dogecoin, for instance. The meme-driven currency that's especially trendy with younger people. It's a token with limitless supply, as opposed to Bitcoin, which has a finite limit on the amount that will ever exist.
There's no real investment thesis here other than the mob is all running in the same direction, so I better run with them. If you can get out before the mob starts to lose interest, you might actually make money. But it's purely based on mob psychology. There's no foundation to any of this based on value, financial analysis. It's simply kind of an expression of group anger at the financial system that is interesting for sure in its own right, that there are so many of these people and that when they work together, they can influence the value of investments to such a degree. But I think in the long run, these people are going to disappear and Dogecoin will fall about 99% lower than it is today. It's just a question of when that's going to happen.
While Yermak is skeptical about Dogecoin, cryptocurrency is already a common asset that many publicly traded companies hold on to. Many of the biggest names on the stock market, from Tesla to Google, are heavily invested.
There are companies that manufacture the mining hardware. There are companies that transact in Bitcoin. Tesla, most famously, has announced a couple months ago that they are holding Bitcoin as the way to bank some of the cash within the company and also accepting Bitcoin as a form of payment. So increasingly, there really are portfolios of regular stocks in the real economy that are highly correlated with the technology. So I would give the same generic advice to almost everybody, which is diversify as much as possible. But you don't intentionally have to go into crypto because many companies are already doing this.
Yermak says that in just the past year, crypto has gained so much ground that many traditional financial institutions are scrambling to get ahead.
You and I grew up with paper dollar bills and metal circular coins that we would carry as change in our pockets. All of that is going to become electronic, and you're going to see a digital dollar, a digital euro. The Chinese have taken the lead in this. They already are launching what is called central bank digital currency. But I think the technology behind this, the blockchain, offers such a degree of security that it's all but irresistible to the central banks. And frankly, if the central banks don't move on this, it will be the media companies. And you've seen this already in China with WeChat and Alipay, who have issued digital payment platforms that are at this point more popular with the public than the regular banking system. And I think the legacy of Bitcoin, ironically, is that it's going to make the central banks even more powerful and give even more central control, while this was exactly the opposite of what the founders were trying to do when they launched this back in 2008.
Cryptocurrency is highly volatile, always changing, and creating new opportunities in the market. But one thing is certain, it's not going away anytime soon. To find out more about this topic and our guest, Dr. David Yermak, visit viewpointsradio.org. For more behind the scenes, search Viewpoints Radio on Twitter and Facebook. This segment was written and produced by Amira Zaveri. I'm Gary Price. Coming up on Viewpoints.
I think it's universally true across various industries, be it restaurants, be it retailers, be it households. People don't know how much they're wasting.
In the U.S., nearly 40% of food produced ends up in the trash. Then,
it's going 17,000, roughly 500 miles per hour. And as soon as it hits the atmosphere, everything starts to heat up.
Commemorating 40 years since the birth of the NASA Space Shuttle, I'm Marty Peterson.
And I'm Gary Price.
These stories in depth on your public affairs magazine, Viewpoints.
That's Viewpoints for this week. Viewpoints is a production of MediaTrax Communications. Follow us on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram to learn more about upcoming shows and find a library of past programs on Apple Podcasts, Google Play, and Spotify. Plus, you'll always find previous segments and more information about our guests at viewpointsradio.org. Join us again next week for another edition of Viewpoints.